Okay. Good morning, everyone. For some of you, some of this presentation will be a little bit of a recap of what you have seen at the TV conference, but I try to make some new things and new ideas here. So the duty was not that clear to me what I should present here, considering the venue, considering the audience. So I decided to give you some thoughts about what's my vision, the problems that I can foresee in terms of evaluating quality of experience, and mostly for this talk, image and video quality. For immersive media, when we are talking these days of multi-views, 3 degrees of freedom, 6 degrees of freedom, and so on, what does it mean exactly? Considering what has been done in image quality assessment communities so far. As a first warning, I want to report to you a story about... this is an old story, actually, more than 10 years ago, when we started to investigate how image quality metrics, that means algorithm that has been developed to predict computationally the image quality, depending on what they are considering or not, how they are robust to different viewing conditions. And on this chart, you can see how, for instance, SSIM, very well known, let's say the new PSNR metric to evaluate image quality. So SSIM stands for Structural Similarity Metric, something that has been quite widely adopted, especially in some venues like MPEG these days. On this chart, you have how SSIM is performing in predicting mean opinion score, which means the score provided by observers when they are watching different images and they have to rate the quality of images. And here we are looking at the correlation coefficient between SSIM and the subjective scores coming from this type of experiment. And you have here 3 data sets which are under study. So what is changing between these data sets? You have the protocol, the way you record the rating. So here you have, for instance, the double stimulus impairment scale. Here this is a single stimulus continuous quality scale. Here it's absolute category rating. So we play with the rating scale here. And we play also with the display condition. At that time, LCD were appearing, and we were comparing the quality using, for instance, CRT display compared to LCD. And as you can see, SSIM, in terms of correlation with subjective score, is not really robust. It's not robust. And the main reason for that is that this metric operates in pixel domain, but does not consider at all viewing conditions. Namely, the viewing distance, the characteristics of the display. So it doesn't consider what actually reaches the signals that is reaching the eyes. So probably it has been tuned in conditions which are closer to this one, but when you start to change the viewing distance, you start to change the display and so on, then you lose robustness. And at that time, we were proposing another metric that was considering, for instance, the display properties. So in the front end of the metrics, you have something which is adapting that goes from pixel to let's say luminance domain, and then you can achieve better robustness. But just a big warning here is that don't take a tool, PSNR, SSIM, or whatever it is, don't expect that it's going to predict your image quality perfectly if you are not introducing a little bit of context. There have been a lot of metrics that have been developed along years. There are, I would say, a few hundred available to predict the image or video quality. But I should say that most of them are working in a kind of little space of among the hyperspace of possibilities that you can encounter in real life scenario. What I mean by that is that most of the metrics, all the metrics, to validate them, to understand if they're performing well or not, they are validated on ground truth, which is a result of subjective assessment protocols or subjective assessment experiments. And the way you design this subjective experiment is kind of somehow can bias the result that you obtain. So in real life, you have to deal with different type of content. You have to deal with different type of distortion level, different type of distortions, lockiness, blurriness. As we are introducing new codec, for instance, we have new type of distortion which are appearing. We have, in terms of content type, you can describe your content in terms of spatial information, temporal information, depth information, color information, and so on. So when you want to design a subjective experiment and to understand how the quality is affected by these different factors, you have to explore all these things. But as a matter of fact, if you look at what we have when we study this type of problem and we run subjective experiments, because they are timely, consuming, and so on, we mostly explore a little part of this space. And all the metrics that we're going to tune, validate, and so on, likely works in this little part of the space. So generalization and so on is not, that's not very interesting. And these days, in the era of deep learning, people, of course, use a lot of deep learning techniques and so on, which are very good to learn what's going on here, but probably not, because this is the ground truth that they have, but probably not able to expand and to be robust out of this little space. So do we learn much when we do this type of things? I'm not sure. This is why people have tried to develop also methodology to the art of designing good subjective experiments. I like this sentence, and I like to quote usually this sentence from Phil Corrivo. So Phil Corrivo, for those who don't know him, was one of the founders of VQEG, Video Quality Expert Group, in the mid-90s. And he's used to say that a metric, a quality metric, is only valid under the condition on which it has been tested. And I think that's a very wise sentence to take off. And as I said before, don't take a tool and expect that it's going to work outside of this. So of course, when we are talking about immersive media, 3DOF, 6DOF, we are playing with also new type of viewing experience, which can be considered as another dimension to tackle. And once again, if you have a metric that works well for previous conditions, there is no objective reason why it should work for this new viewing experience. So I refer some of them here. Eye dynamic range was kind of challenging, and we have some evidence that traditional metric doesn't work for these type of things. Stereoscopic 3D TV, has to be requires also the design of new metrics, and as free viewpoint TV and so on. Okay, so I'm not going to touch this problem here, the content type, because I think Federica will present in the next talk some things that we have investigated together on how to address this content type for immersive media. But yes, I want to stress now that for multi-view videos or VR or 3 degree of freedom or 6 degree of freedom case, we are definitely missing proper metric to do that. And I want to illustrate that with few data sets that we have produced and give you some evidence of that. One of the reasons why we don't have a proper metric for that is because most of the metrics that has been designed before have been tuned on specific artifacts. And with this new scenario, we have very, very special artifacts that has not been considered before, especially object shifting, geometric distortion, SSIM, PSNR, all these type of metrics, they are not able to do to tackle this problem, geometric distortion. You have also these impedancing techniques, flickering, and so on. And one thing which is also appearing with multi-view content or let's say immersive media is that most of the artifacts that we're going to observe are very localized. So they are not, let's say, we cannot consider that the image is uniformly affected by a codec or whatever recipe is used to transmit this. While PSNR, SSIM, all these type of metrics are usually considering that the distortion is uniform. And this is not the case for immersive media. So there's poor hope that this thing will work properly. So that's just an introduction of what I want to discuss now. It's, let's say, we will be in that scenario to present some of the results. So let's say we have a transmitted view. Eventually, we can render and synthesize new views on the rendering side. So there are many sources of artifacts here that comes first on how you compress and you transmit these views, and then on there are other artifacts that comes from the synthesized algorithm that are used, or DIBR algorithm that are used to generate this synthesized view on the viewing side, the rendering side. So one thing that was kind of interesting for us is that if you are in the context of FreeView.tv or interactive scenario, basically you let the observers to switch from one view to another as you want. Okay? And what are the effects of this? That's some stuff that we wanted to study. So let me introduce you some results from a first data set. So the idea here was to check what is the effect of a DIBR algorithm. When we have two reference views, we can play with baseline, okay, between these two reference views, and we try to generate intermediate views. And in that case, so the artifacts comes only from the synthesized algo. So it's still image, time freezing, looking at the effect of this DIBR algorithm. So those DIBR algorithm can introduce very strange artifacts like shifting artifacts, crumbling artifacts. So you have a lot of things that are not that usual in other so far considered scenario for image and video quality assessment development. So the problem is that the usual image quality metrics are mainly based on values of signal characteristics, but pixel-based, and they cannot fully capture this type of artifact. And if you look how they perform in terms of correlation with human mean opinion scores, so the experiment that we ran before, you can see that they are miserably failed. The correlation is not more than 0.3. So that's when I said don't use a metric out of this context, that's at least unknown. So especially for this DIBR like generated artifact, this doesn't work at all. Still, okay. People have tried to propose metrics to address this scenario, especially the DIBR one. So people have fortunately offer some solution for that. So they went from beyond usual quality metrics. And the common ground of all these metrics is that they quantify the change on contours. And they consider that because the distortion on contours is kind of proxy for semantic level annoyance. And they were kind of successful because, so the first one that has been introduced was VSQA. And on the database that was mentioned before, you can see that now we are much better. Right, the correlation with mean opinion score improved from 0.3. Now we have some tools available here that can reach almost 0.9 correlation coefficient. Unfortunately, I don't think that this metric has been adopted by MPEG yet. So that's something we did together with Federica and Marco, this one. And then when we did that, I don't remember. 2013? Yeah, 2013, and now that's the latest state of the art. So yes, we can progressively things for that scenario. You may wonder how it works when we go for video. So that's another data set that we produce. So this time, instead of that's more or less the same idea. You have reference views. You can play with baseline, and you look at the quality of a virtual view. But this time, instead of freezing the time, now we look what's going on all a long time. So this is really a video that we are generating here. And we consider also now some compression artifacts. So we have also compression here. It's not only view synthesis artifact, but also coding artifact. These are the performance of commonly used metrics, once again, on this data set. So it's a little bit better than the previous scenario, because it's not only synthesized artifact here, you have also compression. But as you can see, the best one, which is VSNR, only reach a correlation coefficient around 0.5. So we are not yet there. So even for that scenario, it's not working well. Another data set, or another way to see this problem, because going towards, let's say, interactivity, is to understand what's going on when you start to, let's say, move between views. So in this data set, what we did, we use once again a view synthesis algorithm. We have some reference view, transmitted view. So we have encoded map, texture, depth map are encoded, and we can generate with, let's say, in that case, I think it was VSRS, from the tool that is used for within MPEG for view synthesis. We look at what's going on when you freeze the time, you go from that view, and what's going on if you, from that view, you generate a kind of pseudo video moving from one frame after the other, from one view to the other. So, and in that data set, it was a kind of back and forward video. Okay, so what's going on? It's like a matrix, like a matrix movie, like a video. And once again, if you look at the result of traditional metric, PSNR, SSIM, and so on, this is the correlation that you get. So you have both a person and Spearman correlation here. This is the correlation that you get with this matrix for that type of scenario. I should have shown you some examples, but when you do this type of view, you navigate between the views, you are introducing amazing artifacts, especially if depth map is not well encoded. But traditional metrics are not able to compute that. And finally, recently we investigate the following problem. So now it's really a free navigation scenario, kind of. And so we have reference view, transmitted, compressed, and so on. And we synthesize you again. But then we design some kind of trajectory along time when we move from one view to another. Sometimes we spend more time on some views that contains important object. So we did several experiments to understand how the trajectory can affect, actually, be an influencing factor on the user experience. So that's a problem. If you want to test any system here, which trajectory should you use? You can let any observers experiment what he wants to do with the content, but then it's very difficult to draw some big conclusion, because from one observer to another one, you will get different opinion score. So how do you average that? And inter-observer variability is pretty high. So another alternative is to say, okay, let's try to define some several trajectories, the same for all the observers, and generate this pseudo video and compare the mean opinion scores that we get from one trajectory to another, and try to understand if it's an influencing factor. If it is an influencing factor, that's important, because it may raise the fact that you need, then when you want to compare codec, you need a methodology to select the critical trajectories. So just for sake of time, I'm going to introduce a little bit how it works here, but that's not that important. So we consider that we have different use reference, use encoded camera, synthesized camera based on encoded camera, and so on. And we define trajectory a long time there. So we can generate trajectory as we want. Just here, just to illustrate, we have, in that case, two type of trajectory. And one which is more focusing on object of interest. So we stay a little bit longer on these views. And okay. These are example of a result that we get for one sequence. So for these two trajectories that I presented before, you have here the mean opinion score obtained for these different trajectories, and we play here with baseline, coding parameters, and so on. And we observe actually that the trajectory was kind of affecting, and it depends on the quality. So for high quality, the mean opinion score that you get with trajectory 2 is higher than the one that you get for trajectory 1. And when you reach lower quality, it's the other way around. So it's not only a matter of trajectory seems to be an influencing factor, but also the bit rate that you are using is an influencing factor also between trajectories. So sometimes trajectories are more critical for some bit rates than some others. So we run ANOVA and so on to better understand that if this was really an influencing factor, and it seems that yes, trajectory is an influencing factor. So testing this type of things, we are in trouble now in MPEG. Or to test codec and so on, we are in trouble because you need now a good methodology to select your trajectory and critical trajectory to take decision with codec. The thing that may happen is that for one given trajectory, one interactive scenario, let's say, one way to interact with the content, codec A can be better than codec B. But for another one, it will be the other way around. So that's opened a lot of questions and how we should deal with this problem. Of course, can we do better than the traditional metric to capture the quality? Because hopefully, if we have an objective tool that is performing well for this type of scenario, then we can fix part of the problem. So the last 2 years, we tried to address this problem. And actually, we investigate several representation domain with a common ground, which is we track the geometric distortion. As I stated before, the problem that we get with this use case scenario is that we are introducing a lot of geometric distortion and very localized geometric distortion. So can we find a good representation domain to track this distortion? So we propose different things for that. Some are based on a sketch token approach, so we have a kind of dictionary of sketch token things, and when we, for instance, check two views, we have some kind of surface extraction. We extract features and make some kind of registration between the two views, and then we compare this based on a dictionary. So each patch is described as a set of sketch tokens which are representing somehow the structural information. So this type of representation can be useful to track the geometric distortion. Another approach that we have tried is to do some elastic metric. So when you have, these two lines, we have a metric that is based on elastic matching and try to measure how the curve has been modified, and this is given kind of good result. That's another representation that we have tested is related to convolutional sparse coding. So once again, from data set, we build some kind of dictionary that is based on this CSC representation, and we learn a lot of things. We have a learning process when we basically learn how the structural information is organized, and we learn the geometry of a patch, and then we can get some pretty good result also with this type of representation. But it's still ongoing, and extension to a temporal case is currently one of the focus of our work. Okay, so that was my stuff for MultiView. If I still have time, and I think I have a little bit of time, yeah, I want to touch another problem. So for the guys who were at 3D TV conference, it's, you know a little bit about this story. But I want to speak a little bit about, 360 relationship, how we can evaluate quality for another type of immersive media, and especially in 360, and the role of visual attention and saliency in that field. So, so saliency model or visual attention model. So, for those of you who are not familiar with that, is something that tells you what are the most likely the area of the image that's going to be most likely seen or observed by people. So you can record that with eye trackers, but you have also computational model of that. That means that models that take that input an image or video and tells you, okay, these are the regions that are of interest or likely of interest for observers. So this is a useful knowledge in many multimedia applications. You can do non-uniform video coding with that and trying to preserve the region of interest, assigning more quality there or more bitrate. It's pretty useful also for 3D TV or stereoscopic application, especially to better handle comfort, trying to limit accommodation vergence conflict in the region of interest. And it's useful also for high dynamic range and other fields. It's also a nice proxy for quality of experience, and especially to better understand the artistic intent. So I didn't have the time to explain that at 3D TV Conf. I'm going to explain this a little bit more, so open your ears eventually. So I don't know if you know this picture. Someone knows this picture? Yes, you know. But it's from a photographer, a French one. I'm French. Cartier-Bresson, if you know Bresson. So he was a guy till the end of his life. He was always roaming in Paris with his Leica camera and trying to capture a lot of things of life, especially Paris life. So this picture from Bresson is named An Instant Décisif. A decisive moment. And I guess you get the picture, right? He could capture this moment where the reflection of the guy on the water are just about to reach together, right? So if you look at this image, you have, of course, these things which are kind of interesting, but also there is this motion, movement, emphasized by horizontal stuff. And so a few years back, we developed a computational model for visual attention, and Scott Daly, he was with Sharp at that time, now he's with Dolby, asked me, can you compute the output of your visual attention model for this image? I said, okay. So we did it, and he was giving a talk at, it was for the preparation of a talk at Electronic Imaging on artistic intent, and the role of artistic intent and image quality. And this is the output of the model. So this is a traditional heat map, and basically what it says, warmer is a color, so let's say yellowish, reddish here, the more likely it's going to be salient for observers. And as you can see, the output of this model gives you pretty good insight of likely what Bresson, Cartier-Bresson wanted to capture, especially these things appears to be salient out of the model. And you have also some kind of horizontal things which are capture here. So this is pretty good, because if you have such knowledge and you can model that, you have a computational model which is able to predict that, then you can probably do better encoding or have some kind of a strategy to preserve these areas. So somehow it's good, because it's a way to capture artistic intent. So coming back to 360, visual attention and saliency modeling and so on for 360 can be very useful. Especially, it has been widely investigated and in MPEG for viewport encoding and streaming, non-uniform quality streaming. There was a lot of discussion on What is the best way to represent a 360 content and encode it for interactive streaming, considering that the people don't see the 360, all the 360 at the same time, so you should put the quality on the viewport. It's useful for artistic intent storytelling, and eventually it can be useful also to compute the quality of a 360 encoded, decoded stream. So one question that has been raised, if you want to compute the quality here, let's say you want to use PSNR, where you should compute the PSNR? In the viewport, on the sphere, or in equirectangular representation? So this has been investigated by some people, especially Tour Algebra IMI group, and they presented some results at PCS 2016. But yes, the problem is that if you go for equirectangular image here, and you don't have any strategy regarding the sampling, it's very biased metric, because you have, let's say, if you consider the sphere, the points that represent the equator in equirectangular format are the same in here for the pole, while the pole is only one point on the sphere. So going for PSNR here won't be a good idea. So some people try to weight PSNR, considering saliency. And that's something proposed by people from Stanford. They said, okay, let's take the PSNR formula and add just a weight, which is dependent on the saliency, but how to get the saliency map. So the easy way, and this is what they did, was to consider, okay, we have a head-mounted display. On head-mounted display, it comes for free. Most of them give you the position of the viewport, so the center of the viewport, just tracking the head, and that's a minimum feature if you want interactivity with HMD. So you can get that. And the idea was to build a saliency map where they consider that, given the position of the viewport, all the pixels within the viewport are equally attended. So for one position of the viewport, they take the respective size, put one for all this the pixel of this viewport, and as you have all the head position or viewport position for, let's say, a certain viewing time, you can aggregate that, and finally you get this type of saliency map here in equirectangular format that tells you what are likely the position of the viewport, okay, or the pixels that can be seen. So they use that. So it's kind of saliency map from end movement, considering that we look everything in the viewport, which is a big hypothesis, because it's very difficult to see all the pixels in 100 degrees at a given time. Okay. So we revisit this, because we had a eye tracker embedded in HMD, we wanted to investigate a little bit more of these things. So we compare actually a saliency map from end movement, so considering the entire movement, and here what could be a saliency map from end movement, but using just a Gaussian center in the middle of the viewport, which is what people are usually doing in computational modeling of visual attention. So you see that if you consider, for instance, a 2 degree Gaussian center on the middle of the viewport, which is 2 degrees corresponds more or less to the size of the fovea, you get this type of saliency map. But this considers that actually we look at the center of the viewport. And we were not sure about that. So this is why we run this experiment. So we use a HMD Oculus TK2 and plus an SMI eye tracker embedded in a HMD, and we could record the head rotation plus the eye gaze and the timestamps and everything. So we had the head movement, head rotation, and eye gaze. So we did that with several observers, several type of content, and so on. And the thing that was kind of surprising is when we aggregate all the results across observers, content, and so on, we could derive this kind of PDF, probability density function, of where are the gaze location happening. So in x-axis here, you have the viewing angle difference between the viewport center and the gaze location. And you get this probability when you aggregate everything across observers, content, and time. And as you can see, the peak of this distribution is not the center of the viewport. It's a bit shift. It's quite shift. It's around, the peak is around 12, 14 degrees. Okay, so most of the gaze fixation are happening there. If you look at content influence, you'll see that it's happening whatever the type of scenes. Indoor scenes, outdoor scenes, scenes with human face, you have always the relative gaze point difference from the viewport center and the gaze, it's almost always at the same location. Another funny thing is that this distribution, that's another way to look at that, now we consider the direction, is isotropic. So there is no bias horizontal vertical. So from the center, and you have all the directions are concerned by this bias. Okay. So we call this shape the donut. And so we don't look at the center of the viewport. So using a Gaussian from Edmond, let's say if you have the knowledge of the center of the viewport, using Gaussian to then try to figure out the possible saliency map is not the right way to go. You should better use a donut distribution. So that was kind of a surprising result. We discussed that with a lot of people, and why is so? And we think that it might be an ecological process. So if you want to explore in 360, you have to consider that moving the eyes is less costly than moving the head. Okay, so we don't explore with our head. We can explore with the head when we want really to 360, but most of the information, the visual information that we grab is with our eyes. And especially if you want to look things which are on the top, it's better to move your eyes first than doing this or this. Okay, so that's why we say, okay, it's probably an ecological process. So more or less you stabilize your viewport and then you grab information on peripheral area, if you consider that the center of the viewport can be the center of your fovea. And another thing is that when you are looking in 360, you are not constantly moving your head neither, because it will easily trigger motion sickness. So people get tuned to that. They don't want to constantly move the head. So you explore with your eyes. You don't explore with your head. So definitely, we should not use the make the assumption that we look at the center of the viewport. And that's a recommendation for a systematic weighting. If you don't have eye tracker and you don't have yet a computational model for visual attention in 360, at least you can get the hand motion data that comes for free. And if you just convolve this hand motion data with the donut shape, then you get a fairly good approximation of what has been looked at in 360. And that's a fairly systematic content-wise weighting for head motion data, and you can use it for PSNR, whatever. So just to illustrate what it gives as a result, you have the ground truth here for this 360 panorama. This is what you do with from head motion, the stupid way, considering that you see everything in the viewport, and not just considering the data that comes from the head motion, convolving with the donut, you get that result. And that's pretty good, let's say, approximation of what you would get with an eye tracker, if you had an eye tracker in your HMD. Okay, that was the last quote I wanted to give to you. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. Time for questions. Please, your questions.
The metrics that you introduced, are they available for us to use them too?
You mean the I think so, yeah. So this it's a bunch of it might be more hybrid than just one language because of, but some are definitely yeah available. The complexity is another question.
Yeah. Other questions?
This last study that you presented that was done with images, if I understood right. So are you planning
okay, so actually it's not only planned, it has been done.
Okay,
so most of the, so one of the purpose of this work, or motivation of this work, was actually to drive the people who are working on visual attention modeling, to drive them to address this type of scenario, because we have tons of models for 2D, let's say visual attention model prediction for 2D scenario, but we don't have anything for 360. So last year we organized a grand challenge as part of a IEEE ICME conference, and that was targeting still image 360, and we ran all this experiment, provided the data set, and there were, I think, more than 30 models proposed from the community, including some model from Romatré. And we get pretty decent results. So, and because it was kind of successful, you know, 30, more than 30 models, so we were not expecting that much for us. ICME asked us to organize a new challenge this year, and this year is about video. So we have kind of similar results. They are cooking now. We are presenting data sets and some of these results here. And about the models themselves. So the result of the grand challenge will be presented in July in San Diego. So stay tuned.
All right. More questions?
We have time to have a question at the coffee.
Yeah, but I have a question.
Ah, you have a question.
What about this game with all these metrics? Now, everyone is designing a metric showing that it somehow outperforms the previous ones, and they are all validated over some subjective tests. So what is the way to eventually adopt a metric and start using it, and not to...
Okay.
I don't know. You got the question.
I got the question, yeah. But the answer, I'm not sure. So that was more or less what I wanted to illustrate here. Especially if we are looking at old data set, it's a little bit like the visual attention modeling problem. A lot of efforts are dedicated to a small bubble of the, and people are just providing some kind of incremental result, and we're reaching saturation of result. And especially with deep net approach. So I think that there are three paths that people are trying to follow these days. First of all, the art of designing data set. Second, how to evaluate the metrics. And we don't learn that much from correlation coefficient, RMSE, and so on. Even if I have presented that, these were figure of merit criteria defined by ITU, VQUEG, 20 years ago. And these days, we realize that they are not enough, actually, to seek for robustness. It's like a little bit software development. You don't care if your software works 95% of the time. It's the 5% where it's not working that you have to fix it. And that's a little bit the same for quality metrics. If you look at the thing from correlation coefficient point of view, you're gonna lose that accuracy, this level of detail. So people now are developing framework to better identify where the metrics are not working. And you learn more from the bugs, and you fix your metric then. So that's the second thing. And the third thing is that, how do you build the ground truth? It's not only about the test conditions. It's about how you get the score from your observers and how you process them. And once again, statistical framework are now on the grill to better robustify your estimate of your ground truth.
What is the proper body or organization to make this? Is it MPEG or ITU or VQC, or is there any need of another one? Or
so, what is the landscape for quality assessment? First of all, what are the channels between these groups? And that's questionable. Now, what do we have on the landscape? We have Qualinet. It's a forum. We have VQEG. It's a forum also, expert forum, but with some connection with ITU. So VQEG is not a standardization body. Qualinet is not a standardization body. There are a group of experts who are thinking about stuff like that and then can inject some ideas there. So, and in terms of standardization effort, what do we have? ITU for this type of things, and IEEE. Especially, you have one standard activity, a group named Human Factors for Visual Experience. And I would say that both groups, or both standard groups, have different policy, different way to proceed, and so on. And different latency.
Plenty to explore.
Plenty to explore. Efficiency of all these things these days and communication channel, I'm not sure. That's also, you know, part of the game, because each time, let's say, for instance, ITU try to address something, it's for specific distortion level. And by the time you fix that, you have the good metrics there, then MPEG is coming with new type of artifact and new type of scenario. So kind of chicken and egg problem. Other question?
Yeah.
Hi. Could I just ask about the question of the relationship between the gaze position and the viewport? We know generally that where you look in an image is determined by the task that you've been asked to do.
That's true.
What task were people asked to do in the work that you were doing, and how robust is your donut model to different types of
So just to be clear, in that experiment, where is that? It was a free viewing task. See, I didn't explain that properly, but the task was this one: view as naturally as possible. Okay. So when it comes to visual attention, yes, you're right. There are two streams: the bottom-up one, the top-down. Bottom-up is mostly driven by signals, properties themselves, and top-down is driven by the observers, what he wants to do. And even in that case, in free viewing task, observers assign himself a task, right? So I would say that what we get here is really for free viewing condition. I would not extend that to the way we look at the things for specific tasks. Now, you need the. Usually, the way it is tackled in some visual attention computational model is that then you define the task, you understand what it is, and then you try to inject that in your model, and you have some kind of top down branch to do that. Nevertheless, for this experiment, those who propose models at the ICME Grand Challenge that I mentioned later on, they had included some kind of top down branch. Some models were including, for instance, face detector, car detector. So nowadays you have computer vision algorithms that are pretty good to do that. So they introduced that already in their model to improve their prediction. They introduced also some kind of, they call it top-down, but I'm not sure I'm supporting that. It's kind of bias, like the equator bias, that most of the people look the things in the equator, and that seems to be kind of robust. Some try to investigate how it is influenced by the content. And especially if you have faces, human faces, how this equator bias is moving a little bit. So they have kind of, yes, complex model to do that. And the best model for the prediction of saliency map of the head were including this type of information. But of course, if you go for more specific tasks, that's, I mean, well, you use the image for specific things, then you have to reconsider these things, yes, definitely.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Okay, let's thanks once again.
Thank you.